الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. My beloved brothers and sisters, before I start, I wanted to say something, inshallah ta'ala. What I wanted to say, inshallah ta'ala, is, as you all know, you've come here to seek knowledge. When others have chosen to sleep and to do what fulfills their desires, you've chosen to seek knowledge and to gain the understanding of the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal. And this comes with a reward. This itself comes with great reward. Our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَلْتَمِسُ فِيهِ عِلْمًا سَهَّلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ طَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. Anyone who takes a path to gain knowledge, to understand the religion of Allah, he took that path, Allah will give him a path to Jannah. The path that you came with, what Allah is going to give you in return is a path to Jannah. And that is what each and every single believer wants. Isn't that the case? So whenever you feel tired or you don't feel motivated to gain knowledge, remember that message, that the path that you're on is the path to Jannah. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he carried on in that same hadith and he said, وَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَ لَتَضَعُ أَجْنِحَتَهَا لِطَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ رِضًا بِمَا يَصْنَعُ. The angels, they place their wings over the student of knowledge because the angels are pleased with what you're looking for, what you're trying to seek. لَهُ مُعَقِّبَاتٌ مِّن بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِ يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِّنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. You're being protected. Allah sent angels down to protect you. And that's not it, brothers. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam carried on saying, وَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ لَتَضَعُ أَجْنِحَتِهَا لِطَالِبِ الْعِلْمِ رِضًا بِمَا يَصْنَعُ. The Prophet went on to saying, the angels, the creatures on this earth, they ask Allah's forgiveness for the student of knowledge. حَتَّى الْحِيْتَانُ فِي جَوْفِ الْمَاءِ. Even the fishes in the middle of the ocean, they ask Allah's forgiveness for the person who is seeking knowledge. What you're looking for is the inheritance of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What you're trying to take is the inheritance of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. If your father died, if your mother died, if your children died, and they left behind a lot of money, wallahi, you will not miss that gathering where that money is being distributed. You will make sure that you're there to take your portion. Isn't that the case? How is it possible that you know there is a gathering where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his inheritance is being distributed and you may choose not to come? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he rebuked a people. He spoke against them. Who have the knowledge of this world. They know the dunya. They know how to work. They know how to make money. They are professionals. But they are ignorant about the hereafter. Allah said about them, يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِّنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ عَنِ الْآخِرَةِ هُمْ غَافِلُونَ. They know the dunya very well. But they don't know the hereafter. It's not a good thing that you're so concerned about your daily income, your money, and you go for training. You try to go up the ladder in your job, promotion. How much more money can I make? Do I need more training? But when it comes to the knowledge of the deen, you take the back seat. Do I really need to learn this? Maybe this is trivial, I don't need to know this. But the dunya, you learn everything because you believe it's beneficial. But the deen of Allah is very important, brothers. Learn Allah's religion. Wallahi, brothers, Allah tells us in the Quran, we came to this world today that we're in. This dunya that we're in, we're here for two reasons only. Every single thing that we do, it has to serve these two. Everything we do, it has to serve these two. Pay attention. The first one that Allah mentioned, subhanahu wa ta'ala, is al-ilm, knowledge. You and I were brought into this world to have knowledge. Allah said in the Quran, Allahu alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawati wa min al-ardi mithlahunna yatanazzalu al-amru baynahunna li ta'lamu anna Allaha ala kulli shay'in qadir wa anna Allaha qad ahata bi kulli shay'in ilma. Allah is saying, I created the seven heavens, I created this the seven earth, I created what is between it, so you can have knowledge of my ability, Allah. So Allah created the seven heavens, Allah created the seven earth, and everything between it, لِتَعْلَمُوا, so you can have knowledge. Are we not between the seven heavens and the earth? Why did Allah create us? لِتَعْلَمُوا, so you can have knowledge. Number one, you were created to have knowledge then. Knowledge of who? Allah is saying, knowledge of my ability and who I am. The second is al-amal, action. This is the one that majority of the people know. And Allah mentions it in Surah Dhariyat. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create the jinn or the ins except to worship me. Al-amal. The knowledge that you gained is now manifesting. It's showing on your limbs. Those are the ghaya, the objective of your existence in this world. It is not so you have a good job. It is not for you to drive a nice car. You're not in this world to be a project manager or to have a good 9-to-5 job. Your job has to serve these two purposes. You make money so you can eat and you can gain Islamic knowledge. That's why you go work. You work and you make money so you can implement the religion of Allah. That is what it should do for each and every one of us. So think about that all the time. And the pious predecessors, Salafu Hadi al-Ummah, Sahabatu Rasulillah, the Tabi'een and the Tabi'een, Tabi'u Tabi'een, they understood that. And that is what they lived by. And you know what Allah did for them? Allah gave them Mashariq al-Ard wa Magharibiha. The east and the west, they were controlling it. These were Bedouins. They were wearing flip-flops. They were wearing two cloths. When they went to the Roman Empire and they went to the Persian Empire, they didn't know how to open the castles and the palaces. A Bedouin man, he came to the Roman leader to give him a letter. He has a stick and he has a donkey. Umar sent him. He's coming to the Roman Empire. He took his stick. This is the palace of who? The Roman Empire. He takes his stick and he punches it on the earth. It's a carpet by the old Roman Empire. Costs so much money, but he doesn't know it, so he keeps punching it on the floor. The Roman Empire is like, who are you? What do you want? It's a Bedouin. But what did he do? Did he know the dunya? Did he know how this world? No. He only knew al-ilm wal-amal. And Allah sent the messengers for that. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى. Al-huda, the scholars, they said, is al-ilm al-nafi'. Allah sent the messengers for this. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى. وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ is al-amal al-salih. Al-amal al-salih, righteous actions. Nabiullahi Muhammad, he came to accomplish that. And he came to spread that beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. That's just a muqaddimah, an introduction that I wanted to give inshallah ta'ala before we go into the lesson. Today inshallah ta'ala, in our explanation in the muqaddimah, in aqidah, we're going to talk about al-qawa'id, which is principles, And we're going to speak about al-usul, which are foundations pertaining to the manhaj ahlus sunnati wal jama'ah, the methodology. Of Ahl Sunnah. Principles that we need to understand and fundamental points regarding the methodology of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. These are foundations. You need to memorize them and you need to know them. The first qa'idah, al-qa'idatul ula. The first qa'idah, the first principle that you need to understand is anna masdar al-aqidah. Huwa al-kitabu. Wa sunnah. الصحيحة والإجماع. The first qa'idah, first principle that we need to understand, that the methodology, the aqidah and the mu'taqad, the belief of Ahl Sunnah is built on أن مصدر العقيدة, the source where we take our عقيدة from, is number one, الكتاب. Number two, السنة الصحيحة, the authentic سنة. And number three, الإجماع. The كتاب of Allah is where we take our عقيدة from. We take our عقيدة from the authentic سنة. Okay? The authentic Sunnah, the Sunnah that's sahih, authentic. And the what? Al-Ijma'ah, consent. Masdar al-Aqidah, the source. Masdar means what? Source. Where Aqidah is taken from. Where is Aqidah taken from? Al-Kitabu, the Book of Allah. Was-Sunnah al-Sahihah, the authentic Sunnah. And ijma'. This is Ahlul Sunnah. What leaves? Ahlul Sunnah do not take their aqidah from aql, logic. They don't. Aqidah is textual. Aqidah is what? La majala lirra'i fihi. It's textual, no logic comes into place. Knowing Allah and the hereafter and the ghaybiyat, the unseen, it doesn't have place for any logic. It's textual. Are we all together? Based on naql. Good. So we'll speak on this more inshallah later. Also, it doesn't come from al-dhawq. Al-dhawq means senses. Manamat, dreams. Aqeed is not taken from that. And it's not taken from what? Al-dhawq. This is what it feels like. This is how I feel it is. Or this is senses. Aqeedah is not taken from politics, siyasa. Siyasa and politics, aqeedah is not taken from that. That because this is the political reality that's taking place around the world, because of that we need to believe this. No. Aqeedah is textual. We also take it from the kitab and the sunnah. The sunnah, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe, whether it's mutawatir. Mutawatir means if it's multitude narration, or whether it is ahad, few in narration, the number is little, it doesn't matter. Aqeedah is still built on that. Whether the people who transmitted, who narrated this hadith to us are little in number or they are large in number, it doesn't matter. We still take it. If it meets the condition of authenticity, as long as it's authentic, are we all together? An ijma' means what? Consensus. The consensus is a source of what? I'tiqad for us. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُسْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ. Anyone who goes against the Prophet's path, he deviates from the Prophet's path. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى. After guidance comes to him. And then look what Allah said after that. وَيَتَّبِعَ. And he follows غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, other than the path of the believers. He follows other than the path of the believers. Who were the believers when this ayah came down? At that time, Sahabatu Rasulillah, the companions. So Allah said, going against the Prophet's path and going against the path of who? The Sahaba is number one, but not only them. It says believers. This is where ijma' comes from. We can't go against the path of the believers. Does that make sense? When the ummah unanimously agree on something. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, Imam Tirmidhi narrated in hadith Ibn Umarin, he said, لَا تَجْتَمِعُ أُمَّتِي عَلَى ضَلَالَ. My ummah will not come together on misguidance. It's impossible. Do you believe this ummah that love to disunite, that love to disunite, that love to differ, they're going to unite on something? What does it show you if they unite? What does that show you? That they believe it. This is what it is. Does that make sense? So the unity of the ummah on something is an indication that it's haq. Because the ummah won't. Are we all together? The Prophet said, La tajtami' ummati. My ummah will not unite upon misguidance. Now, I am not speaking about majority. No. There's a difference between the majority and there's a difference between consensus. Okay? Majority can be wrong and the minority is right in Islam. Are you with me? It's not the issue of majority and minority. Are you with me? Rather, the Quran shows that the minority is majority of the times right. وَإِن تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَن فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّكَ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. So the Quran does show that the majority is not necessarily the right way always. So there's a difference between ijma' and jumhur. Okay, don't confuse the two. Ijma' means everyone agrees. There's no differences here. Everyone is. Are we all together? The types of ijma' is two. There's a sarih. Sarih means I ask you, what's your view? 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 I ask every single body in this room, what's their view? And they all say the same thing. This is direct. Everybody says their view. Sarih means what? Directly. Everybody, he utters, he announces his view. This is direct. Are we all together? Does that make sense? This is hard, lakin, to get everybody's view. What do you think? Everybody. There's another type which is sukuti. Which is also called غير صريح. It's not direct. Akhuna Ilyas says something in the room, and when he says something, he, for example, says, this is what it is. And I look at the rest of you and no one speaks. No one objects. Everyone else is quiet. Can I say you all agree with him? Are you with me, brothers? It's the second type of ijma'. This one is disputed greatly. Whether it's a what? Whether it's a proof. So one Sahabi says something in a particular land, in a particular place, but we have no one objecting, no one saying, I differ with you. Silence. Everyone's quiet. This one is a dispute. Okay, ijma' sukuti. There's a khilaf. Are we all together, brothers? Am I making sense? This one, the dispute of whether it's a proof or not, is when it is taking place at one particular timing. But if it carries on and the next decade, the next century comes, the next 100 years come, and then the next 100 years come, and no one is saying anything. This is called what? Tatawul al-zaman. So Ilyas said it. No one objected. Ilyas passed away, all of us here died, next generation came, no one's still speaking against what Ilyas said. It's been mentioned in books, it's spreading, no one's objecting. And then the next, and then... Now they said this is a hujjah now. And there's a consensus that this consensus is correct. Does that make sense now? Now they don't differ. Are we all together, brothers? They only differed at that moment when the ijma' comes, or he says something and no one objects. They say at that moment, it's not a proof yet. Are we together? Because we need to verify if the rest heard. They may not have heard it. It may have not reached them. But if he said it, and then it gets documented in the books, and then that time finishes, and then the next generation come, and then the next generation come, and no one is speaking about his statement in objection to it. No one is objecting. Now this becomes what? It becomes a proof. We'll say the Ummah united on the statement of who? One Ilyas. Is it ijma' on this issue now? Are we all together, brothers? I also want you to remember something, which is this term ijma', some scholars, they used it loosely. Okay? Some scholars, they might say, this is a mas'ala which is ijma'. They might say that. And then you find there's a khilaf. So just because you read somewhere, this mas'ala is unanimously agreed upon, don't always think it is. Because this scholar, in order to say there's a consensus, it's hard. And to pierce an ijma' is very easy. Because if somebody says, Ilyas said this, I just need to find one person in this room who goes against him. The ijma' is broken. Is it not? It becomes jumhur and? It becomes the majority and the minority. One person, Ahmed, can break the kalam of Ilyas. That's it. There's no ijma' anymore. Does that make sense? So when some scholars, they say consensus, ijma', don't always think this is it, it's ijma'. Look more into it. Okay, brothers. Look what? More into it. Another point. Some scholars, when they use the word ijma', they don't mean ijma' what we understand it. They actually meant ijma' as jumhur, majority. Their usage of the word ijma' and jumhur was synonym, like Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the great Mufassir, when he uses the word ijma', he doesn't mean consensus that we understand now. Does that make sense? Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the great Mufassir, who did tafsir of the Quran, his usage of the word ijma' is jumhur, majority. Does that make sense? So try to learn the scholars, their usages. Are we all together? It's important. So one more time. The first principle, al-qa'idatul ula, the first principle is, according to the methodology of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, is anna masdar al-aqidah, the source that we take our aqidah from. Where do we take our aqidah from? Huwa al-kitab wa-sunnah as-sahihah wal-ijma'ah. Why? All three of these are infallible. They are errorless. Are you with me, brothers? It's infallibility. Al-Kitab is infallible. The Sunnah is infallible. There's no mistakes in the Sunnah, which is Sahih. Are we all together? And Al-Ijma'ah. We just said, لَا تَجْتَمِعُ أُمَّتِي عَلَى ضَلَالَ. If the Ummah unanimously agree upon something, this is infallible. There's no mistake. It's correct. The Prophet said this, alayhi salatu wasalam. Are you with me, brothers? Lakin your aql is not infallible. Are you with me, brothers? Your aql is not fallible. Your aql can do mistakes. Today you say something and tomorrow, oh, subhanAllah, I was wrong. You come back from it, your own self. Are you with me, brothers? Also, aql is based upon induction. Having isti'ab and istiqra of things. Being able to look at everything. Are you with me? Like the man who said, every creature, when it chews, the bottom jaw moves. What moves? Every creature, when it eats, the bottom jaw moves. So when you eat, the top one stays still, and your bottom moves. He said, this is what it is. He followed up. This is his conclusion. Are you with me, brothers? Then they saw a crocodile or alligator. Hey, yeah? What happened? It puts the bottom one on the floor and it whacks it with the top one. True or false? Huh? So this man's tatabbu' and istiqra is naqis, it's deficient. It just, like in Allah Azza wa Jalla's kitab and the sunnah and the ijma', because Allah has told us that it's infallible, it's complete, it's everything's been seen through it. Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? Am I making sense? So that's why in your life, whilst you live, inshallah ta'ala, make your source of evidence kitab wa sunnatu sahihati wal ijma'. Now we're going to move on to the next qa'idah. Before I move on, I want to say this statement of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. This principle is very vital. If anybody goes against Ahlul Sunnah in the masdar, the source which they take their aqeedah from, so if they don't take the kitab and the sunnah to sahihat and ijma' as a masdar, as a source, they leave the fold of Ahlul Sunnah straight away. This is what makes you Ahlul Sunnah. Are you with me, brothers? If a person doesn't take the kitab, or he doesn't take the sunnah, or he does not take ijma' as a source of evidence, he doesn't. Is he considered to be from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah? Question. Is he considered to be from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah? No, he's not. Are you with me, brothers? No, he's not. He's not from Ahlul Sunnah. He's considered from the deviated groups. The question here is, does proof have to be established on him or not? Before we say he's not from Ahlul Sunnah, do we have to establish the proof on him? فَهَلْ تُقَامُ عَلَيْهِ الْحُجَّةِ Do we say, first of all, don't say nothing? We're not going to speak about whether he's from Ahlul Sunnah or not. First of all, let's establish the proof. And then after that, if he rejects, we say he's from Ahlul Bidah. Are you with me, brothers? So do we establish the proof against him? And then we give him the title? Or do we give him the title before we even establish the proof on him? Scholars like Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, Qawam al-Sunnah, Abu al-Qasim al-Taymi, Abu Qasim Hibatullah al-Lalakaiyu, Al-Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, and others, they said, La tuqamu alayhi al-Hujjah. Proof is not established on him. Because he hasn't entered Ahlul Sunnah in the first place. Proof will be established for him to be brought into Ahlul Sunnah, not to determine whether he's from Ahlul Sunnah or not. Does that make sense? And that's the strongest view according to Ahlul Sunnah. Are you with me, brothers? Pay attention to this point. If a person goes against Ahlul Sunnah in the Kitab and the Sunnah to Sahihat and Ijma', he says, this is not evidence for me. Logic is where I take my deen from. My aqidah is based upon my rational, my logic, I think, and that's where I take my deen from. Or, Khabarul Ahad, few in number, narrations. To me, it does aqidah, I don't base that on it. And etc. This person is not considered to be from what? Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. That's already agreed upon, right? That he's not from Ahlul Sunnah. But is the proof established first and then is he said he's not from Ahlul Sunnah, or he's not from Ahlul Sunnah before the proof is established on him? Before he's told. I said four scholars. Abu Qasim Hibatullahi Allah Lakai Qawam Sunnah, أبو قاسم هبة الله الألكائي سوري قوام السنة أبو قاسم التيمي شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية الإمام أحمد رحمه الله الأوس ابن القيم they mention he is from the deviated groups and he is not considered to be from أهل السنة even before the proof is established on him but we do convey the message to him to bring him into أهل السنة we go to him and we tell him this is wrong come into the belief of أهل السنة does that make sense brothers That's vital. Masdar al-Talaqi takes you out of the fold of Ahlul Sunnah mubasharatan. This is a fundamental issue. What does it do? It's a fundamental issue. وَلِذَلِكَ listen to the statement of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. The rest, it's too long for me to quote them. Like, let me quote for you Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah, he says, فَمَنْ قَالَ بِالْكِتَابِ وَالسُنَّةِ Anyone who says the kitab, meaning he uses the kitab as his evidences. He uses the kitab as his in source. وَالسُنَّةِ and he uses the sunnah. وَالْإِجْمَاعِ and he uses the consent. What does this say? فَهُوَ مِنْ أَهْلِ السُنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ He's from أهل السنة والجماعة. This is also the opposite. A person who's saying to you, أخي, I take kitab, السنة الصحيح and إجماع as my deen. You can't say to him, you're not from أهل السنة والجماعة because you don't like my sheikh or you don't agree with my sheikh. Does that make sense, brothers? It's vital again, it's another point. This individual has taken the kitab and he has taken the sunnah الصحيحة and he has taken the إجماع and the, as what? As his مصدر, this is his evidence. Are you with me, brothers? مباشرة this man has come through into أهل السنة. Ibn Taymiyyah says this. فهو من أهل السنة. Are you with me, brothers? Even if he's not in your inner circle, or he's not with your group, or he's not with your jama'ah, or he doesn't retweet your statements and your quotes. فَهُوَ مِنْ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ Whether you like it or not. He's from what? وَلِذَلِكَ brothers, wallahi, one thing we have to understand. Shaykh al-Imam Ahmed said something very powerful. He said, إِخْرَاجُ النَّاسِ عَنِ السُّنَّةِ شَدِيدٌ Taking a person out of أهل السنة, he said, it's severe. Ahmed saying this, rahimahullah. إخراج الناس, taking a person out of أهل السنة and saying he's a مبتدع. شديد, it's a severe issue. It's a dangerous issue. That when you are looking into a matter, know the principles of أهل السنة. And if you don't know, then don't busy yourself with what you don't know. القاعدة الثانية, the second قاعدة. We're going to now go into القاعدة الثانية. We're going to go into القاعدة القاعدة الثانية the second قاعدة القاعدة الثانية أن المرجع أن المرجع في فهم الكتاب والسنة أن المرجع في فهم الكتاب والسنة هي ما عليه السلف الصالح Okay The second qa'ida is very important We've just spoken about the Where do we take our evidences from? Where do we take our aqeedah from? Al-kitabu Wal-sunnah and what? Wal-ijma'ah How do we understand the Qur'an? How do we understand the Sunnah? And how do we understand the Ijma'? How? A person gives us a kalam, a statement of Allah in the Qur'an. A person gives us a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. How do we understand it? Are you with me, brothers? This point is vital. This issue is vital. This point is very important. Reason is because today the concepts that are being pushed, that the religion of Islam needs to be reinterpreted. What does it require? It needs to be reinterpreted. We need to revolutionize Islam and look at the text. What's the right way of understanding it? We don't need that. As Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, do we need that? No. We've already got a way to understand the Quran and the Sunnah, and that is based on whose understanding? It's based upon ma alayhi salafu salih. Anna marji'a, the reference point in understanding the Kitab and the Sunnah. Understanding the Kitab and the Sunnah is what? Bima alayhi salafu salih. That which the pious predecessors are upon. We have to look at the pious predecessors, how they understood this text. So if a person brings you an ayah from the Quran and he says to you, قال الله تعالى, listen, when he says this is what Allah means, we'll say, wait. Who said this is what Allah means from the Salaf al-Salih? That's your golden question. Don't let somebody just throw an ayah at you. Say, who from the Salaf al-Salih understood the ayah like this? Who from the Salaf al-Salih understood the hadith like this? Are we all together, brothers? Why? The reason is the Salaf al-Salih, they have more knowledge in the Arabic language than we do. These were Arab aqhah. Pure Arabs who understood the language of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Arabic that has reached us today is diluted, it's changed. As over time, it started to change. That's why grammar was placed. ولذلك the poet said, وأول من ألف في الكتب محمد بن شافع المطلب وغيره كان له سليقة مثل الذي للعرب من خليقة. The Arabs, they already knew the language. So this language that the messenger is talking, they understand it better than you. Even if you're an Arab, the Arabic that you speak and what they spoke, their one is the elite language, the pure one. Are you with me, brothers? That's the first reason. The issue pertaining to the Arabic language. Number two, they ayan tanzil. They saw the revelation come down. They saw the surrounding. They saw the Prophet's reaction. These are eyewitnesses. If a car accident happens, who do you listen to? Who does the police ask the report from? The eyewitnesses or somebody who comes hours later? Let alone years later or centuries. Who does the police take? The eyewitnesses, those who saw the incident, who saw what happened and saw what took place. Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? The Sahabas are eyewitnesses. They saw the Prophet. They knew what was happening, the environment, the situation and everything. So when they inform us, they're talking about what they saw. Are you with me, brothers? Third reason is their heart was better than our hearts. They did not have any hidden agenda. Are you with me, brothers? For us, the person looks at the ayah and says, subhanAllah, this ayah today is not working in my favor, forget it. And he'll bring another ayah supporting him, and he'll push that forward. The companions, they were sincere creations of Allah. Their hearts was pure. And they had no hidden agenda. So when it came to the text, the kitab and the sunnah, it was based upon what will take them closer to Jannah and the hereafter. How many times did Umar and Abu Bakr and the Sahabas do a mistake and they came back from it? Are you with me? And we find that a person might do a mistake, he knows he did a mistake, but instead of coming back, what does he do? He still carries on in that road. When he doesn't understand الرجوع إلى الحق فضيلة, to come back. If your intention was Allah, and that's what you were doing it in the first place, then coming back to Allah is not a problem. Sahaba were innocent, they were innocent and they were sincere. Are you with me, brothers? So for those three reasons mainly that we mentioned, the understanding of these people is great. Not to mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He praised them. وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ. Look, Allah mentioned in this ayah three types of people. Allah says, السَّابِقُونَ. Allah says, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ. وَالْأَنصَارِ الْأَنصَارِ. I ask you guys, is any one of you here from the Muhajirin? Are you with me, brothers? Is anyone here Muhajir? From the Muhajirin here? You might have done Hijrah from India or the UK, but I mean here, Muhajirin, the companions who migrated from Makkah, are you from them? No. So we've lost this golden opportunity. It wasn't written for us. Ansar, are we from the Ansar? Are we from the Ansar? Allah mentioned a third type of people, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ, and those who follow them. This is where we can come in. وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ, those who follow them. This is our opportunity, brothers. Look what Allah says after that. رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ. Allah is pleased with three parties. The Muhajirin, and the Ansar, and those who follow them. That's the people Allah is pleased with. I think it's Surah At-Tawbah, ayah 99. It is Surah At-Tawbah, but I think it's ayah 99 or ayah 100. Pay attention here now. You can only be from the third party. That's when you get that statement of Allah. Radiallahu anhum. Allah is pleased with you then. Are you with me, brothers? If you don't get to become the followers of the Ansar and the Muhajirin, which is the Salaf al-Salih, then you're going to lose out from being those who Allah is pleased with. Okay? So when you understand an ayah, when you understand a hadith, base it on the understanding of the companions of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay. And we're going to now go into the next point, inshallah ta'ala, al-qa'idah al-thalitha. Jazakallahu khairan. Qa'idah al-thalitha is anna usul al-deen. كلها بينها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قد بينها النبي The third qa'ida Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah upon is anna usul ad-deen, the fundamental matters of the religion, the foundational issues of our religion. قَدْ بَيَّنَهَا النَّبِيُّ, the Prophet clarified it. بَيَانًا كَافِيًا شَافِيًا. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he clarified everything for us. Pay attention to this, brothers. It's not like the religion of the Christians. What are the religion? The most fundamental thing of their religion is divinity. Of who? Isa ibn Maryam. That's their usul. It's an asal issue for them. Is Trinity a fundamental issue for the Christians? Yeah. Is it? They can't explain it to you. Is what makes you a Christian Trinity, true or false? Explain it then. Tell me what it is. They can't explain it. Then how is it that the thing you have to believe in order to become a Christian is not clear? Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? Our religion, anything that's fundamental that you have to know, Islam has clarified that for you. What has not been clarified for you is not a fundamental issue. You don't need to know that. The religion doesn't need you to know that. Are you with me, brothers? Allah says in the Quran, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. Today I have completed your religion for you. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي, and I have completed my blessing unto you. ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا,
And I have become pleased with Islam as your what?
As religion.
Islam as your religion. Islam clarified everything. Everything is clear. ولذلك look what the Prophet ﷺ he said, قَدْ تَرَكْتُكُمْ عَلَى الْمَحَجَّةِ الْبَيْضَاءِ لَيْلُهَا كَالنَّهَارِهَا لَا يَزِيغُ عَنْهَا إِلَّا هَالِكَ. The Prophet said, I left you on a path. What's this path? That this path has no night, just day. Clear. Like, this day is clear, right? I have left you a clear path. There's no night. There is no night. أبي ذر رضي الله تعالى عنه يسأل لقد توفي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وما طائر يقلب جناحيها إلا ذكر لنا منه علما. الله أكبر. أبي ذر he said, الغفاري, the great companion, he said that the messenger died. وما طائر, and there's no bird in the sky, يقلب جناحيها, that flaps its wing. Except he told us something about it. What is he trying to say here? Look at the Quran and the Sunnah. The Prophet told us so much about the bird. Did he not say to him, لو أنكم توكلتم على الله حق توكله لرزقكم كما يرزق الطير تغمو خماصا وتروح بطانا. If you relied on Allah the way that the bird relies on Allah, it leaves with an empty stomach. It doesn't know where to get its rizq from. But the bird goes. The bird goes and it flies, not knowing where it's going to get its food from today. It doesn't know. But it relies on who? Allah. And it comes back for not only food for itself, but food for who? For its children. It has food for it. Well, here I want to mention a beneficial point, which is that this concept of having big reliance on Allah. If you look at us today, we went through longer stages, or we've been through stages, sorry, in our lives where we were not in any control of how we live. Allah was controlling it. If you look at when you were in the womb of your mother, who was providing for you? When you came out and you came into this world, who was breastfeeding you, looking after you and feeding you? You were working. Now that you have become something and you are far from this earth and this tall and this strong, you think you can take control of your affairs alone? No, wallahi. This is something you have to ponder over. The affairs are still in Allah's hands. It's in His hand, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who took care of you in the womb of your mother. When you were a sibling, a child, a little kid, Allah took care of you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now that you're at this age, He's still the one that's going to take care of you. وَفِي السَّمَاءِ رِزْقُكُمْ وَمَا تُوَعَدُونَ. That the provision for the person is in where? Is in the sky. And if you think of the bare minimum, the poet, he said, he was talking about what can take a person's hunger away. If a person today went and he took a dry bread and he took water and he broke it and he ate the dry bread and he drank water after it, after a period of time, would he be filled up? Yeah, would he be full from it? Yeah, he will be full from it. He will become full from it. The one who eats in, huh? A five-star hotel, who expends so much money, both of us are full. At the end of the day, we're both full. Are you with me, brothers? So why am I too stressed? What you have to understand from this hadith is that Abu Dharr is saying that the Prophet clarified everything for us. There is not a bird that flaps its wing, except the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What did he do? He told us something about it. Salman al-Farisi, the Persian companion, he said, Ahlul Kitab, the people of the scripture, they came to him and they said to him, لَقَدْ أَخْبَرَكُمْ رَسُولُكُمْ. Your messenger has informed you and he has told you كل شيء, everything. And Salman al-Farisi said, yes. He even told us when we go to the toilet how to deal with our call of nature. He told us, أَلَّا نَسْتَقْبِلَ الْقِبْلَةَ وَأَلَّا نَسْتَدْبِرَهَا. He told us not to face the Qibla, not to face away from the Qibla. He even told us how many objects that we should use when we're doing our call of nature. If the messenger taught the companions how to use the toilet, will he forget Asluddin? Would he forget the fundamental issues of the religion? I ask you this, brothers. Would he? No. He's told them everything. Everything that they need to know. So our religion did not leave a path that will take you closer. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in another hadith, مَا مِن نَبِيٍ بَعَثَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ حَقًّا أَن يَدُلَّ أُمَّتَهُ عَلَى خَيْرِ مَا يَعْلَمُهُ لَهُمْ. Every prophet, it was an obligation on him to convey to his people any good that he knows that will get them closer to Allah and that will take them to Jannah. Every prophet had to tell his people. And Nabiullah Muhammad, did he do that? Did he tell us about every path, every road that can take us to Jannah? Did he tell us? He told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Idan aqeedah al-sunnah is, when they look at the Qur'an, and when they look at the sunnah, they know that it's salihatun li kulli zamanin wa makan. That the religion is good and it befits every situation and every time. Are you with me, brothers? And the reason why some people say, my solution is not in the Quran and the Sunnah, so I have to go to psychologists and I have to read this and I have to read that, is not because it's not in the Quran, wallahi it is. And not because it's not in the Sunnah, wallahi it is. It's because our understanding has become so less and our comprehension is so little that we think it's not there. Are you with me, brothers? The third qa'ida, the third principle is, the fourth one, right? Okay, the fourth one. Okay, that was the, those three are the three most. We'll stop there, inshallah ta'ala. It's those three, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. And now we'll go into, inshallah ta'ala, we'll go into the other subject, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh. Any questions? تطاول الزمان. Should I write for you? تطاول الزمان. تطاول means the continuation and the carrying on of a time. تطاول الزمان. So some people they say to you, إجماع السكوت is not a حجة like that. نعم, it's not a حجة. If there's no tatawul al-zaman. But if there's a tatawul al-zaman, it's a hujjah according to the ijma' of the ulama. Okay? Faddal. Qiyas. Qiyas in aqeedah is no place. Lakin in fiqh, yes. Okay? In fiqh, na'am. We use qiyas as a source of evidence. Are you with me? Lakin it has to meet the qiyas which is accepted in fiqh is not, there's two types of qiyas. Qiyas which is fasid al-i'tibar. We don't give it no consideration. Are you with me? And that's the qiyas of who? Iblis. Iblis, what did he say? Adam is made out of clay. I am made out of fire. Fire is better than clay. So I'm not going to prostrate. This is a qiyas. Lakin it's a qiyas fasid al-i'tibar. Are we together, brothers? That's not the type of qiyas we're talking about. We're talking about the qiyas that meet a conditions. The first condition is, the scholars, the asal, and there's a fara' and there's a illah. Okay? All of this we'll speak about in more details. For example, alcohol. Okay? We have what? Alcohol. Did the Prophet ﷺ prohibit alcohol? Nah. So as time went on, new substance was seen. We started to see cocaine, cannabis, and things like that. Okay, the Prophet didn't say that. This is liquid and this is powder. So the asal here is the khamar that we have. Sah? The asal is the one that the Prophet stated, which is the khamar. The fara is what? The drugs that we have, okay? So we write drugs, okay? Lakin, what's the reason why the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prohibited the alcohol? What was the illah? What was the reasoning behind it? Huh? Is that it intoxicates, right? Is the intoxication found in the drugs? Then the illah is shared between the two. This qiyas is good. We have an asr, we have a farah, we have an illah, we bring it together. We have now followed the correct method. This qiyas is sahih. So now what we say is, the fourth thing is hukum, which is the ruling. The ruling becomes what? Haram for drug. Does that make sense, brothers? This is the qiyas. We apply this, and inshallah ta'ala we'll speak about all of this in usul al-fiqh. Okay, brothers? Yeah. Okay, good. Very important point. First of all, this concept of dividing the religion into usul and furu'. Okay? We're dividing the deen into what? Usul, and saying that religion has things that are fundamental and furu', things that are sub-branches. Okay? Dividing the religion into usul and furu'. They say that the first people who introduced this concept were the Mu'tazila. They were the first people to say that the religion has foundations and the religion has furu'. If you read Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah's works, you realize that he's against the idea of dividing the religion into furu' and usul. And in other places, he's actually saying usul and furu' himself, Ibn Taymiyyah. So in some places, he's objecting and he's rejecting and he's refuting the concept of dividing the religion into usul and what? And into furu'. And in other places, he himself is saying this is asal in the deen and this is furu' from the religion. So, after looking at the works of Ibn Taymiyyah, you realize what he's trying to say is the following. Okay, you listening, brothers? What he's against is those people who say aqidah, al-aqidah is a usul, and al-fiqh is what? Are you with me, brothers? Because within fiqh, there's what? Usul. He hates the idea that you make all of fiqh furu'. Within fiqh, there are issues which are usul, fundamental issues, such as salah, zakah, sawm, and hajj. They are pillars of Islam. And they are not furu'. A person cannot just say, I don't believe in salah. And we say, oh, it's a fiqh issue, no problem. Can we say that? It's a fundamental issue. ولذلك, what you find in Kutub al-I'tiqad, they brought tariq al-salah. The one who leaves the salah, is he a kafir or not? They dragged it into what? Are you with me, brothers? Al-mas'u ala al-khufayn, wiping over your socks. Is that a fiqh issue? But why do you find it in books of i'tiqad? It's a fundamental issue because this is what the Sunni and the Shia differ on. Are you with me? It became the symbol of Sunnism and Shia don't believe wiping over your socks. They wipe over their legs. Are you there, brothers? Am I making sense? Jihad, is it a aqidah issue or is it a fiqh issue? It's a fiqh issue, but it's a fundamental issue. Are you with me, brothers? Jihad is in the books of fiqh. But it's a fundamental issue that got dragged into aqidah. Are you with me, brothers? So this is what Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah is talking about. And this is the point that he's trying to drive home. Not to say that fiqh is all furu', and because it's furu', there can be difference of opinion regarding it. No. There are three issues in fiqh that don't tolerate and don't accept difference of opinion. Does that make sense? Even though they are fiqh. Does that make sense? Now here is those issues that some of the scholars like Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, he put under aqidah as furu'. Like, did the Prophet ﷺ see Allah in this world? This issue the companions differed on. So they differed in a far'i issue. Sahabas, not in the fundamental issues of Aqeedah. Are you with me, brothers? Okay. وَهَلْ يُعَذَّبُ الرَّجُلِ أَمِ الْمَرْءِ بِبُكَاءِ أَهْلِهِ. If your family cry for you, will you be punished in your grave? Aisha rejected this. Anyways, the scholars, they try to reconcile between the speech of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, but you find those issues. Did the messenger say? So even though it's an aqidah related issue, but it's a far'a. They never differed on the asal, which is, will Allah be seen or not? That's a fundamental issue. Are you with me, brothers? Am I making sense? So don't say the sahabas differed in what? Aqidah, that's wrong. Because when you say the sahabas differed in aqidah, the overwhelming majority of issues of aqidah are what? Usul. Never say that the sahabas differed in aqidah. Rather, what you say is the sahabas differed in a mas'ala min masail al-furu'. Are you with me, brothers? Because that statement of saying that the sahabas differed in aqidah is a kalam which is muhim. It gives waham to the people that you can't differ in aqidah. Are you with me? Does that make sense? And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Uthaymeen and others, Shaykh Salah al-Fawzan and others, they point that out. That one should not say that. Does that make sense? Fadal. Naam. If the person takes the Quran and the Sunnah, and he takes the Sunnah and bima kana alayhi salafu salih, and then after that he differs on what they meant here and what were they saying, this mas'ala does not take the person out of the folds of Ahlul Sunnah. As long as he's taking the Quran and Sunnah, as sahiha and ijma', and that which the Salaf were understanding as the text, then if the conclusion goes against what the Salaf said, then of course it's going against the Salaf. If he's contradicting what the Salaf said, an application and that, he's applying it different to how they applied it, then na'am, he's wrong. If he misunderstood it, then proof will be established against him. Okay? You see, I distinguished between the issue of Al-Kitab wa Sunnah wa Al-Ijma', I put it on one issue, and the Bifahm Salaf al-Salih, I put it under another qa'idah. Sahih? The first one I said, the person leaves the fold of Ahlul Sunnah straight away. Like Bifahmi Salaf al-Salih is another issue. Okay? It's another discussion. No.
Ustad, if anyone who takes another person out of the realm of Ahlul Sunnah because they differ with his sheikh, is this person out of Ahlul Sunnah, or is he a person who's a sinner?
No, he's not from. He doesn't leave Ahlul Sunnah because he's saying Al-Kitab al-Sunnah. As-Sahih and Ijma'ah, he himself is saying that, so you can't take him out. Lakin, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, anyone who does nasbul wala'i wal bara', love, allegiance, and hate based on an individual, or the statement of an individual, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, this person becomes a hizbi. This is what a hizb is, right? What's a hizb? What's a hizb? Now, what does it mean? Hizb means partisanism, right? This is what, even if this person keeps saying, I'm fighting against Hizbiyah, it still doesn't take it away from him that he's a Hizb now. Why? Because the only individual whose statement we base love and hate on is the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He's the only human that we do that. Everybody else, his kalam cannot be based on what? Al-Wala'i wal-Bara'. Walidarika, brothers, Imams who were from the A'immatul Sunnah, some of other A'immatul Sunnah did not like them. Do you know anyone greater than Imam al-Bukhari as Imam Ahlul Sunnah? Who's Bukhari? Who's Imam Bukhari? You see, the fact that your silence means, would you ask us about Bukhari? Bukhari, he himself at his time, there were people who didn't like him. Like who? Imam al-Dhuhali rahimahullah, he did not like him. Dhuhali is an imam min a'immatus sunnah, and Bukhari is an imam min a'immatus sunnah. And no one said, Dhuhali, you don't like Bukhari? That means you don't like the sunnah. Are you with me, brothers? And Imam al-Shafi'i, his title was Nasr al-Sunnah. That was his title he was given. Yahya ibn Ma'in did not like Shafi'i. He refuted him, or he spoke against him. Yahya ibn Ma'in is with who? Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ahmed, when he was told that Yahya ibn Ma'in is speaking against an Imam Shafi'i, he said he doesn't know who Shafi'i is. I know him. But then, Ahmed is still with Yahya ibn Ma'in, and they're still together. And no one said, you're defending a person who I spoke against. Are you with me, brothers? This is a mas'ala that requires... ولذلك, if you look at two scholars, go to the tarjama of Muhammad Nasr al-Marwazi in Sir Alam al-Nubala. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi brings it in his Sir. Muhammad Nasr al-Marwazi, he argued with Ibn Mandah. They were both going at each other. Okay, because they're contemporaries. Each person was correcting the other person. And look what he said. This is who? Al-Imam al-Dhahabi. He said, if we take down Muhammad Nasr al-Marwazi and we take down Ibn Mandah because of what they said against each other, what will remain for us in terms of the religion? How many knowledge did Muhammad Nasr al-Marwazi transmit to us? And how much knowledge did Ibn Mandah transmit to us? Should we take them both down? The whole knowledge, a lot of portion of knowledge is going to go. Because both of them, what they had against each other has nothing to do with Qala Allah and Qala Rasul. It's personal issues. Scholars then made a qa'ida, which is Kalamul Aqrani Yutwa Wala Yurwa. The statements of contemporaries, they are tossed over the shoulder, they're not given no weight. As long as the differences is based upon what? Personal issues. Okay? Scholars never gave it that much weight. And wallahi, one thing I'll tell you this. Even that all of those scholars fought, through history, there was always tanafus. There was people going at each other, righteous people. Wallahi, I never read in history students getting involved. Underline that point. Historically, this issue of scholars refuting each other was always present. Lakin never, at the time of the ulama al-jahabidat al-nuqad, never do you see the students getting involved and speaking. People, I don't even think, can they be given the title of being called students? But let's use a loose term and say they are students of knowledge. Okay, getting involved and speaking about these issues that are greater than them. It's a darar, the harm that comes from it, only Allah knows subhanahu wa ta'ala. Naam. We take both, ahad and mutawatir. No, it does not affect the authenticity of the hadith. If a hadith is mutawatir or ahad, we will take in our aqidah. And it does not affect authenticity. Authenticity and whether a hadith is sahih and mutawatir and ahad are two different things. Okay, scholars only look at five things when it comes to authenticity. Okay, five things. We'll speak about that when we speak about the introduction of hadith, inshallah ta'ala. Okay? Not whether it's mutawatir or ahad. Mutawatir and ahad are authentic. Okay? They are accepted. Fadal. If the Jumhur is majority, okay, the majority can be right and it can be wrong, okay? Okay, it can be right or it could be wrong. Like in Ijma', which means everybody agreed, there's no difference here. This is a proof. Are you with me, brothers? It's a what? It's a proof. But if it's Jumhur majority, we still look into it. We might agree with the Jumhur, or we might even differ with them, because we might say the Dalil is not on their side. Okay? The majority of the scholars said this. That's what it means. Yes, that's what it means. Okay? We're going to now start the Ulum al-Quran, inshaAllah ta'ala.